radioactivity. The spontaneous decay of unstable nuclei by emission of certain subparticles like alpha, beta, gamma radiation is known as radioactivity. Suppose if you take any unstable nuclei, like let us say this is X, it disintegrates into daughter nuclei. So this radioactive nucleus, which is called a parent nuclei, so this is called a parent nuclei, and the nucleus resulting from its decay by particle emission is called a daughter nuclei. So let me take it as Y here. So this is called a daughter nuclei. So in this process, from the parent nuclei you will get a daughter nuclei plus some radiation here. Let me write this as R. So this is the radiation. This radiation may be, this may be alpha, beta or gamma. And during this, we can see some energy will be emitted in this process, and this is the energy emitted in this decay process. Here, during the radioactivity, all conservative laws must be observed. That is, law of conservation of mass, law of conservation of energy, law of conservation of linear momentum, law of conservation of angular momentum, law of conservation of electric charge, law of conservation of spin, and as well as law of conservation of nuclear number also. In certain processes, proton number also conserved. Here, let us say the mass of the parent nuclei, let us say this is mx. So I am going to write mass of this one as mx, mass of this daughter nuclei is my, and mass of the radiation that is produced is mr. Then how to find this energy? That energy may be released, energy may be absorbed in this process. So here what you can write, this you can write mx square, that is mc square is can be written as mx square, where mass of the parent nucleus is given in kgs. So this is mx square. This must be equal to mass of the daughter nuclei into c square plus mass of the radiation into c square plus the q value. So this is the equation in terms of the energies of this radioactive process. Here q is the energy released and is equal to the total energy carried by the reaction products. So here how to find q value? Q can be written as this minus this minus this. So which you can write mx minus my minus mr into c square. So this is a q. Here this q is nothing but delta m into c square. Now thus the disintegration energy is a negative of the binding energy. If q is greater than 0, the nucleus is said to be unstable. Let us say this q greater than 0, the nuclei is unstable, and q less than 0, nuclei is stable. Here as it is q, here it is the negative of the binding energy. So energy q is equal to minus be. That's why if be is positive, that is stable, be is negative, unstable. But here the conditions will be reversed. Here in any radioactive process, there are some conditions. It is completely unaffected by the physical and chemical conditions to which the nucleus is subjected. That means we cannot change the radioactivity by applying high pressure or by applying high temperature or by applying a strong electric field. So this is completely unaffected by the physical and chemical conditions. Second one, a nucleus can disintegrate immediately or it may take infinite time also. So we cannot say that this reaction will be complete within fraction of a second, or we cannot say that this reaction is going to complete in one day. So the nucleus can disintegrate immediately within a fraction of a second, or it may take infinite time. Hence we can define a probability for the number of nuclei that may disintegrate in a given time interval. So we are just going to find out the this much amount of nuclei can be disintegrated into this. So we can find only the probability. And the third important point is the energy liberated during the radioactive decay comes within the individual nuclei only, not externally. in alpha decay, this is the equation. So alpha is nothing but a helium nucleus only. This is the helium nucleus. Now, a nucleus emitting alpha particle loses two protons. Here you can see atomic number decreases by 2 and mass number decreases by 4. So this is the parent nuclei. This is the daughter nucleus and this is the alpha particle. And this Q is the energy released here. So that is called a disintegration energy. Therefore, when alpha particle loses, it loses 2 protons as well as 2 neutrons, 4 neutrons. Now, the mass number here decreases by 4 and the neutron number decreases by 2 here. So this is the equation for alpha decay. For example, if you take this 88 Re 226, when it loses this alpha particle, the atomic number decreases by 2 as it loses 2 protons here, and then it converts into radon and its mass number decreases by 4 here. 226 minus 4 is equal to 224, plus it produces this helium nuclei, and this energy released in this process is it is estimated as 4.87 MeV. This is the energy released in this process. Remember, students, alpha decay takes place only if the mass of the parent nucleus is greater than the mass of the daughter nuclei. So that is the condition here. Here, what is this Q value? How to get this Q value? Q value is given by mass of the parent nuclei. This is the parent nuclei minus mass of the daughter nuclei, this one, minus mass of alpha into C square if the masses are given in kgs. If the masses are given in AMUs, then you can write this as mass of X, mass of Y, mass of alpha into 931.5, then you will get this in mega electron volts. But here, let us say, if I want to find out this value in terms of kinetic energies, let us say there is a parent nuclei which is initially at rest. So parent nuclei is at rest and it is emitting 2 particles here. So this is the daughter nuclei. This I am denoting with Y, and it is also emitting one alpha particle. Let us say this is a alpha particle here. Size will be very small. And this is the daughter nuclei. This is the daughter nuclei, parent nuclei and alpha particle. Now here, in this process we can say, as this is splitting into two parts, we can write, according to law of conservation of linear momentum, this Y as well as alpha will move in opposite directions with the same linear momentum. So I am going to substitute this value. As this is at rest, the initial momentum will be 0 before splitting here. So after that, this is the momentum of Y and plus momentum of alpha particle here. So as these two are equal here, because this is equal to 0, initial momentum is 0 here, total initial momentum. So we can write Py is equal minus P alpha. Here minus indicates that if Y is moving in one particular direction, alpha will move exactly in the opposite direction. So magnitude wise, Py is equal to P alpha. So their magnitudes are, linear momentum magnitudes are equal here. Now, I am going to substitute this value Py and P alpha. We know that Py is the linear momentum, which is equal to root over 2mky here. So momentum can also be written as root over 2 into my alky here, where my is the mass of daughter nuclei, and this is equal to root over 2 m alpha k alpha here. So this is the condition. So from this we can write ky by, here 2 to get cancelled, ky by k alpha is equal m alpha by my. So let me take this equation 1. Now, using the kinetic energy conservation, as the initially this body is addressed, or that parent nucleus is addressed. So what we can write, the kinetic energy of this one, which is given by kinetic energy of daughter nuclei ky plus kinetic energy of this alpha particle k alpha, this must be equal to the total energy that is released here, that we call it as disintegration energy. Now from this we can substitute by using this equation 1 as well as equation 2 here. From this I can write ky plus k alpha is equal to q. So I am going to substitute in place of ky, I can write m alpha k alpha by this one. So here I am writing m alpha k alpha by my, because see this ky is equal to kinetic energy of y nucleus is equal to, by cross multiplication, m alpha k alpha by my plus this is k alpha, this is equal to q. Here you can see this k alpha common. So what is k alpha, kinetic energy of alpha particle in this process, which is given by, this is m alpha by my, k alpha common, m alpha by my plus 1 is equal to q. So k alpha, if you take LCM here, this will come m alpha plus my by my. When it goes that side, my by m alpha plus my into q. This is the kinetic energy of the alpha particle in alpha decay. Similarly, what is the kinetic energy of the daughter nuclei? Because both are moving in opposite direction with the same momentum. So here we can write the kinetic energy of the daughter nuclei is given by mass of alpha particle by mass of alpha plus mass of y into the total energy, disintegrated energy. So this is the equation for kinetic energy of daughter nuclei. This is the kinetic energy of alpha particle. But we know that the mass of alpha particle here in this one is 4. The mass of daughter nuclei is a minus 4. So from this, what is this ky by k alpha? This can also be written as ky by k alpha is, can be written as mass of alpha particle, which is equal to 4, mass of daughter nuclei, which is equal to a minus 4 here. This is the a minus 4. So this is the relation between ky by k alpha. In beta decay, actually it is of three types here. We have three types of beta decay. One is negative beta decay. Second one, positive beta decay. Third one is called electron capture. That means beta decay involves the emission of either electron. Here negative beta decay means it emits electrons, or it emits a positron here, or it may capture the electron also. We will learn about this one. First let me discuss about these negative and positive beta decay. A positron is the antiparticle of electron. So this is actually positron here, antiparticle of electron, which is having same mass but charge is positive here for positron. Now the electron or positron emitted in beta decay do not exist inside the nucleus. Say nucleus will not have that electron here. They are created at the time of emission, just like photons are created when electron in the atom makes a transfer from higher energy orbit to lower energy orbit. So here, suppose if electron is jumping from higher energy orbit E2 to lower energy orbit, so during this transition, it emits a photon. So photon is created while electron jumping from higher energy orbit to lower energy orbit. Similarly, in beta decay also, this electron will be created when this beta decay takes place. The conservation principle of energy, linear momentum and angular momentum are apparently violated in beta decay. That means energy is not conserved here, and momentum is not conserved here. This momentum, linear momentum is not conserved. Even the angular momentum is not conserved here. So they are apparently violated in this beta decay. But in alpha decay, these are conserved there. Now, What is this negative beta decaying? In negative beta decay, a neutron is transformed into proton and electron with the emission of antineutrino. So that I am going to write as this neutron will be converted into a proton here plus one electron here plus and one antineutrino. This is called antineutrino here, nu bar. So here previously they observed that neutron converts into proton electron only, but after that Pauli's discovered that this is the antineutrino that is produced in this negative neutron decay. So as it is electron is negatively charged here, so we call it as negative beta decay. Here to conserve the momentum, to conserve the spin, to conserve the angular momentum, the antineutrino is emitted here. So before finding this antineutrino, it is found that beta decay does not obey this law of conservation of momentum, law of conservation of spin, law of conservation of angular momentum. But after discovering this, it is found that it obeys all these laws. Before emission of beta particle, the momentum of the parent nucleus, let us say this is zero. So if the momentum is zero, so sum of these three momentum must be equal to zero. So from this what we can say, as the momentum of this parent nucleus, momentum P of parent nucleus is zero, the total momentum of these products must be equal to zero. So from this we can write, the momentum of the antineutrino is equal to the sum of the momentum of this proton produced here plus sum of the momentum of the electron produced here. So the momentum of the antineutrino equal to the sum of the momentum of proton and electron produced here. Now the antineutrino that is produced has no electric charge and also its rest mass is very very small and closest to zero. Now how to represent this one generally? We can write this as ZXA, this is the parent nucleus, by emitting beta particle here, that is negative beta, converts into Z plus 1 Y, that is a daughter nucleus with the mass number remains as it is, plus as it is emitting this electron, we can write like this, plus antineutrino plus that energy released here. Now in general what we can write, for example here atomic number of this daughter nucleus increases by 1 unit, but mass number remains as it is. So the example, general example for this negative beta decay is, suppose if you take 6C14 carbon isotope, by emitting this beta particle, this will convert into 7N14. So here atomic number increases by 1 unit, mass number remains as it is, minus 1E0 plus antineutrino plus that disintegration energy that we can write as Q here. Negative beta decay takes place only if the nucleus having too many neutrons when compared to this number of protons, that means relative to protons. So when the number of protons are more, then the excess neutrons will try to convert into protons and also emits this beta particle or electron here. But if the nucleus consists of too many protons when compared to the number of neutrons, then positive beta decay takes place. So in this process what happens, here one of the proton, an excess proton, converts into neutron here plus and it emits one positron here. This is not electron, the antiparticle of electron is called positron, plus it emits one neutrino. Neutrino is the antiparticle of antineutrino. So this is anti, this is neutrino, which we call it as antiparticle of this antineutrino. For example, if you want to write this in the form of an equation, general equation, just like ZXA gives Z plus 1 YA plus this one, for positive beta decay, here you can write ZXA is the nucleus which is having more number of protons than the number, relative number of neutrons. So the Zdx-A comes into here, it converts into Z minus 1 Y, the mass number remains as it is, plus, and it emits one positron here, 1E0 plus 1 neutrino here, mu, plus it emits some energy Q here. Here also you have to write the Q here. For example, if you want to write the example for this one in general, the example is, for example, if you take 7N13, that is also the nitrogen isotope. So this has more number of protons relative to the number of protons in its nucleus. It converts into 6C13. Here you can see Z decreased by 1 here. So 7 will become 6 plus plus 1E0 plus neutrino plus Q is the disintegration energy in case of beta decay. But what is this electron capture? The Thor method, electron capture. So electron capture in this mode, the parent nucleus captures one of its own orbital atomic electron and emits a positron with a neutrino. So here I can write, electron capture is also due to excess protons relative to neutrons only. So this is also due to this one. Why? Because it is absorbing or capturing one of its atomic electron, that is orbital electron, the electron that is revolving inside its own orbit. And finally, it emits a positron. So it is emitting a positron here. So this is similar to this positive beta decay. So how to write the equation, general equation for this electron capture? So I am going to write this as Zxa due to this electron capture, because it is capturing one electron. So that also you have to indicate here. So by capturing one electron, that is minus 1G0, what happens to the atomic number here? So LHS, left hand side, this is Z and minus 1. So this should be Z minus 1 only. So this you can write Z minus 1. Y is the parent datum nuclei. And as the sum of the masses are A plus 0, it remains as A only. Plus it emits here one positron. Plus, together, as it is similar to this positive beta decay, it also emits one neutrino and plus the disintegration energy. Best example for this one is, suppose if you take 4Be9 beryllium, by capturing one electron from the beryllium atom itself, because electrons are revolving inside the beryllium, so there are 4 electrons in each atom. One of the electrons will be captured by this one and by the nucleus of the beryllium here, then it emits one positron here, and due to this 4 minus 1, it will become 3 lithium here. So what is the mass number here? The mass number remains as 7 here. This is 4Be7. This is also 7 here. So LHS side, we have 4 minus 1. RHS size 3 plus 1. And anti-neutrino plus Q here. So sometimes here you can see beryllium 4 and by capturing this electron. But you can have to see that this is 3, this is 1, this is 4 only, because this is from this same atom itself. Generally, atoms will have different energy states. An atom is said to be in ground states if electron is present in this original orbit only. So for example, suppose if you take Na, this will be 11 this atomic number, 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s1. This s orbital will have 2 electrons which are in the ground state. It means they are present in the first orbit only. These 2 electrons are present in the second orbit. 6 electrons are present in the second orbit, p orbital. And one electron is available in the third orbit, S orbital. But if you supply some energy, this electron can jump to fourth orbit or fifth orbit. Then it is called a excited sodium atom. Similarly, even the nucleus can exist in one of its number of quantized energy state, that is excited state, similar to an atom. Now, such type of these excited nuclei which are unstable can return to its ground state by emitting the photon or single photon or so many photons. Here you can see the 27 cobalt 60 by emitting a beta here, electron or negative beta, it atomic number increases by 1 here and the mass number remains as it is. This is in the excited state. During this state, what happens? The energy decreases here. The difference between these energies will come out in the form of these photons here. These are known as gamma photons. Here in the first transition, it emits a gamma photon of 1.17 MeV energy. But after that, in second step, the same 28 nickel 60 in the excited state once again emits one more gamma photon of energy 1.33, because the energy difference between these two steps is 1.33 MeV. So as a whole, the condition or the general equation for this one is given by ZXA gives ZXA only. Here 28 nickel 60 by emitting this gamma, it gives 28 nickel 60 only. Once again by emitting one more gamma in the second step, it remains as 28 nickel 60. But the difference between these two is, this is in the excited state. We are denoting this with an arrow, star here. But this is in the ground state. During this one, it emits one gamma photon here. So this is the general equation for gamma decay. Then here, law of radioactive decay. What is this radioactive law? So it states that the rate of disintegration of a given sample is directly proportional to the number of nuclei present in that sample. Remember, if you take any element here which contains so many atoms and which it consists of so many nuclei here, in this nuclear decay, the nuclei do not decay all at a time. Here what happens, they decay one by one over a period of time. And one more important point is, this decay is random and a statistical process. That is, each and every nucleus has an equal chance of disintegration at any time. We cannot predict that exactly which nucleus in a sample is going to decay. So we cannot say that this is going to decay now, or after that this is going to decay. No, it may not happen like this. This may decay now, and next this may decay, and then next this nuclei may decay. So we cannot predict it exactly, but what we can determine how many nuclei in a sample will decay in a given time. So this is the rate at which the nuclei will decay in a given time, and this is directly proportional to the number of nuclei present in that sample at a particular time. So from this, what we can write, this dN by dt can also be written as dN by dt, that is called rate of disintegration is equal to minus lambda n, where lambda is decay constant. And here we know that minus indicates that the number of nuclei are decreasing with the time. So from this we can write dN by n is equal minus lambda dt. By integrating this on both sides here, the initial number of nuclei, let us say this is n naught, number of nuclei after given time is n, and here this time, this is 0 to t. So now by integrating this equation, we will get this dN by n is log n. So this is log of n with limits n naught by n, which is equal to minus lambda t. So from this equation, by subtracting this value, log n by n naught is equal to minus lambda t. Or the law of integration states that n by n naught is equal to e power minus lambda t, or n is equal to n naught e power minus lambda t. So this is the law of disintegration. So we can write this as n is equal to n naught e power minus lambda t. Suppose if you take a graph between the initial number of nuclei or the parent atom, let us say X converts into Y in this nuclear reaction with some radiations here, that may be alpha, beta or gamma. So what are the number of X nuclei initially? So this number of nuclei initially, let me take it as N naught here. So they gradually decreases as it is a exponential equation. So this decrease will be exponential gradually. Similarly, what are the number of Y nuclei? Initially, when the number of nuclei are N naught, NX, that means there are n naught number of nuclei which are X, then zero nuclei will be available, that is Y. So this equation will be like this, this graph will be like this, this will be like this. Means after some time what happens, this is NO or nothing but NX here, this is NY. NY is zero initially when time is zero, and NX is nothing but NO, that is initial number of nuclei. Now as the time increases, here I will take this time as a half time, this will be same here, that is N0 will become N0 by 2. So the time that takes in this radioactive decay, where the number of initial number of nuclei becomes N0 by 2, is called a half time. There, this is the point where NX and NY are equal. So after that, what happens? This will try to decrease to 0, this will try to increase to N0 here. So that will be, takes place at infinite time. The number of decays per unit time are also called decay rate, is called activity, generally we denote with this R. We know from law of radioactive decay, N is equal to N0 e power minus lambda t. The rate at which decays takes place, that is, if you differentiate this one with respect to time, this dN by dt, this we call it as activity here. So we will take only the positive value, that is mod of R, which is equal to, this is differentiating this one, N0 is a constant, bring it outside. Differentiation of e power minus lambda t will be e power minus lambda t only, and the differentiation of this one minus lambda. As I need only positive value, this activity can be written as N0 lambda e power minus lambda t. So this R can be written as R0 e power minus lambda t. Here R0 is nothing but lambda N0. This is called a initial activity, that is the rate of disintegration at t is equal to 0. So this is called a initial activity, that is R at t is equal to 0. Now if you take this decay constant, this activity can be measured in different units here. The SI unit of activity generally is a becquerel. Generally we denote this with BQ. So what is one becquerel? One becquerel is nothing but one decay per second. But after that, we have some other units where Curie is also a unit for this dN by dt or activity. So here in general, in problems they will give, they will denote activity in terms of Curie. So this is a 3.7 into 10 power 10 decays per second, because a radium nuclei emits a 3.7 into 10 power 10 radiations or decays per second. That's why it is taken as, this is the decay of radium, which is taken as Curie here. Similarly, we have one more Rutherford also. One more unit for this one is Rutherford. This is taken as SI unit, and these are the other units. One Rutherford is equal, this is equal to 10 power 6 decays per second. If a nuclei can decay simultaneously by different processes or n processes, then what we can write, which are having these activities R1, R2, R3 and 4, the total resultant activity is given by the sum of the these activities, that is R1 plus R2 plus R3 and so on. So the total activity can be obtained by adding all these activities simultaneously. Now, what is this decay constant, that is lambda? Lambda we will discuss now. Decay constant, it is the reciprocal of the time during which the number of nuclei decreases to 1 by e times the original value. Now, if you take this decay constant, it is the characteristics of the sample taken or does not vary with the time. So this lambda remains constant. If a nucleus can decay simultaneously by more than one process, let us say n processes, then the effective decay constant is also equal to sum of these decay constants here. As we know that R is equal to R1 plus R2 plus R3 and so on, Rn. R is equal to lambda n here. this is lambda 1 n, lambda 2 n and so on, lambda at n n. If you cancel this n n n, so then you will get lambda is equal to lambda 1 plus lambda 2 and so on, lambda n. Time here. Half-life time of radar sample is defined as the time interval during which the activity of a sample reduces to half of its initial value. That means the rate of disintegration decreases to half of the rate of disintegration. Now here what we can write, we know from this equation, if the number of nuclei present at any time is equal to exactly half of the number of initial number of nuclei, so this is the equation, n will become nr by 2, cancel these two, so this is 2 power minus 1 is equal e power minus lambda t, as both are negative, you can write e power lambda t is equal to 2, and this particular time is called half life, we are denoted with capital T, e power lambda t is equal to 2, this t is called half life. Taking log on both sides, you will get lambda t is equal to log 2 base e, t is equal to log 2 base e by lambda. So this is the equation. So half time period is given by, we know that this exponential value is 2.718, and this you can write 0.3010 into, and as it is not to the base 10, if you write this in base 10, this will become 2.3 then divided by lambda, so this value will be 0.693 by lambda. So this is the equation. Half-life of radioactive substance A is 4 days. Find the probability that a nucleus will decay in 2 half-lives. So each half-life is given as 4 days here. Now according to this equation, let us say there are n naught initial number of nuclei, they will be converted into n naught by 2 in 1 half-life, that is in t seconds or t days or t years or maybe. Now this n naught by 2 will become n naught by 4 in 2 half-lives, and n naught by 4 will become nr by 8 in 3 half days, and you can see the relation here. In this relation we can see that this nr by 2 can also be written as nr by 2 whole power 1, so this is nr by 2 whole power 1, because these are the number of nuclei that are undecayed or number of nucleus that are nuclei available after one half life. This can be written as nr by 2 whole square. This can be written as nr by 2 whole cube. So this is in 1 half life, this is in 2 half lives in 3. So now here there are 2 half lives. So what are the probability that a nucleus will decay in 2 half lives? So what are the number of nuclei undecayed here? That is nothing but n. That is n is equal to this, according to this formula, n is equal to nr by 2 power n. So that is n is equal to nr by 2 whole power n after n half lives, but in this problem it is given as 2 half lives, so this remaining number of nuclei will be n naught by 2 whole square here, because here n is equal to 2, so this can be written as n naught by 2 whole square, means this will be n naught by 4. That means initially this substance has n naught nuclei, now after 2 half lives it will become n naught by 4. So what is the probability a nucleus to decay in a given time? Here probability is given by 1 minus this probability of nucleus to be left undecayed in 2 half lives, that is nothing but 1 by 4, so this will be 3 by 4. Here a rock is 1.549 years old. The rock contains uranium-238 which disintegrates to form PB206. Assume that there are no PB209 in the rock initially, and it is the only stable product formed by the decay. Calculate the ratio of number of nuclei of uranium-238 to that of PB206 in the rock. Half life of uranium is given as 4.519. Here actual time given is 1.5 into 10 power 9 years, and the half life is given as 4.5 into 10 power 9. These two get cancelled. 1.4 ones, 1.4 twos, threes. So this is 1 by 3. These are the number of half lives in this problem. What they are asking, they are asking to find out the ratio of number of nuclei of uranium to the T to that of Pb in the rock after this many years. Initial number of nuclei, let us say this is N0 of uranium to the T. After this 1 by 3 half lives, what are the number of nuclei that are available? Number of nuclei of uranium. Number of nuclei of uranium 238 that were left after 1.5 into 10 power 9 years. This is gone by, we know this equation N is equal to N naught by 2 whole power N. So this N is equal to N naught by 2 whole power N. Here it is 1 by 3. So then what are the number of Pb atoms formed in this same period? Number of nuclei of Pb209 formed in the same time, that is 1.5 into 10 power 9 years. So this is nothing but number of Pb n dash is equal. Out of this many are left alone. So the remaining will be converted into Pb here. So this is N naught minus N naught by 2 power 1 by 3. I want the ratio between these two. So that is N by, that is number of nuclei of Pb206, sorry, uranium 238 by N dash. So this is N naught by 2 whole power 1 by 3 by, remaining are N naught minus N naught by 2 whole power 1 by 3. You can see this N0 get cancels. The remaining terms are 1 by 2 whole power 1 by 3 by 1 minus 1 by 2 whole power 1 by 3. In the problem itself, they have given 2 power 1 by 3 is 1.259. So if you take LCM here, this will be 1 by 2 power 1 by 3 by, this is 2 power 1 by 3, 2 power 1 by 3 minus 1 by 2 power 1 by 3. Here this 1 by 2 power 1 by 3, 1 by 2 power 1 by 3 cancelled. Remaining is 1 by 2 power 1 by 3 is given as 1.259 minus 1. So this is 1 by 0.259. You can see this is nearly 0.25. 1 by 0.25 nearly 4. But as it is less than, greater than 259, so answer will be less than 4. So in the options you can check this value, but this is there are no options here. So this answer is nearly 3.89. Average life or mean life. Remember, radioactivity is a random phenomenon, because we just cannot predict which of the nuclei in a given sample will decay first and when. In decay process, some of the atoms of the given sample may have very short lifespan, so that means they can decay very easily. Similarly, others may not decay even after a very long time. So different nuclei will decay at different times. That's why we will measure this average life of the given sample, which is the lifespan of individual nuclei by total number of nuclei. So in this case, so I am going to find out the formula for this tau, which is average life or mean life here. The number of nuclei at a given time, initially when T is equal to 0, the number of nuclei generally we denote with N0. Number of active nuclei at a given time after T, so let us say T is equal to T, the number of nuclei will be N. Number of nuclei which decay in a time, let us say from T to T plus TT, in this small interval of time, the number of nuclei decay, let us say this is dn in a small interval of time. So which is given by lambda n dt. We know this expression. Now the sum of all these dn nuclei in this one is given by, just multiply this with T. So the total lifespan is given by lambda into n dt into this time by the total number of nuclei initially, this is n naught. Now, to get this value, I am going to integrate this one from 0 to infinity, because the initial time is 0 and the maximum time will be infinity. So, now the t average is given by, that is tau is given by integral of lambda n dt into t from 0 to infinite divided by n naught. So, this is the equation. So, from this you can bring this lambda outside, because lambda is a constant. So, I am going to take this as a lambda outside here. And what is n here? N is nothing but from law of decay. So, this n can be written as n naught e power minus lambda t into dt integral 0 to infinite by n naught. So, now you can bring this lambda outside, and by integrating this one, n naught will get cancelled here. So, from this equation, we can write lambda integral e power minus lambda t into dt from 0 to infinite. So, now this by using this integration, integral e power minus lambda t also t only, and this is a UV formula that you know how to solve this problem. And from this you will get lambda of this t into e power minus t by minus lambda whole power 0 to infinite minus integral of 0 to infinite, this is e power minus lambda t by lambda t dt, e power minus lambda t by lambda t dt. You might have studied this in mathematics. So, from this, if you simplify this equation, this tau is given by e power minus lambda t by lambda square from infinity 0 to infinite, which is given by 1 by lambda. If you substitute this one, t value, and if you substitute all these things, you will get t as 1 by lambda. Derivation is not required. Just remember that average life period is equal to 1 by decay constant of that given sample. Life is given by t half is equal 0.693 by lambda, but 1 by lambda is tau. So, from these two equations we can write that t half is equal 0.693 into this 1 by lambda is nothing but mean time. So, if you bring this one this side, t half into divided by 0.693 will become 1.4, this equal to 1.443 equal to the mean life. Successive disintegration. A parent nuclei may decay into a daughter nuclei, that already discussed. X may become Y. So, X is the parent nuclei and Y is the daughter nuclei. And this which may decay into another daughter nuclei, let us say Z. Here, this is the parent nuclei, daughter nuclei. And for this, this Z, this will become act as a parent nuclei and this is daughter nuclei. Or sometimes, this decay continues and this is known as successive disintegration, or also called a series decay. The chain stops only when the end product is becomes stable. If Z is stable here, this reaction will stop here. If Z is not stable, it will produce A, it will produce B. So, continuously parent, daughter, parent, daughter, parent, daughter. So, for everything, the previous one is parent, the next one is daughter. So, it will continue till we will get a stable nuclei here. Any adjacent nuclei may be considered as a parent and a daughter nuclei in this process. Here, let us say, when t is equal to 0, initially, there is a nucleus known A, which is having number of nucleuses n naught. And let us say it can decay into B as well as C. So, what are the initial number of nuclei of B and C when t is 0? Initially, the substance has only a nuclei and that are equal to n naught. Now, after some time t is equal to t, what about this number of A that are present there? The number of nuclei that are present here is given by this dn n1, let me take this as n1
which is also equal to Na, I can write, this is Nr e power minus lambda t. So these are the number of atoms of our nuclei of A present to operate time t here. At the same time, what happens to B and what happens to C? Let us see, these are N2, this is N3, let me take this as N1 for this one, N1 for this N2, this N3. Here you can see that lambda 1 is the decay constant of this process, lambda 2 is the decay constant of this process. So what is the rate at which A decays here? So A is decaying at a rate of this dN1 by dt. The rate at which N1 is decaying, this is equal to lambda N1. This is also rate of formation of B, because when A converts into this B, so this is A here and this is also the rate at which B is formed. Similarly, what is the rate of decay of B here? B decays into C. The rate of decay, that is, this, if you differentiate this with respect to time here, dN by dt will be lambda 2 N2. This is also formation of C. For rate of increase in number of nuclei of P. Here, at what rate this N2 is increasing? The N2 is increasing, that is dN2 by dt is given by the rate at which B is formed, the rate at which C is formed. So that is lambda 1 N1 minus lambda 2 N2. If C is not formed, this will be lambda 1 N1 only. If C is also formed here B is increasing at this rate and from this C is formed at this rate. So this is the rate of increase in number of nuclei of B. Similarly, what is the rate of number of nuclei of C here? The number of nuclei of C will be lambda N2, lambda 2 N2 only. Now, here I am going to write this as dN2 by dt can be written as, this is lambda 1 N1 and you can write this lambda 1 N1, if you bring this one this side, dN2 by dt plus lambda 2 N2 can be given as lambda 1 N1. This is the given equation here. Now from this what we can write, if you multiply this with e power lambda 2 t here, so this e power lambda 2 t, this N1 can be written as, this is Nr e power minus lambda t. Now what is this lambda? This is nothing but lambda 1 t here. Now this multiply this one with e power minus lambda 2 t, that is this one for from B to C. Now by writing this equation you can write e power lambda 2 t, otherwise multiply with e power plus lambda 2, this will get dN2 by dt e power lambda 2 t plus lambda 2 N2 e power lambda 2 t is equal lambda 1 N1 e power minus lambda 1 t plus lambda 2 t. This is the equation. Now from this you can see this is lambda 1 N0 e power minus lambda t. You can take t common here, lambda naught N0 e power, if you take t common, lambda 2 minus lambda 1. You can write this equation as, this can be written as d by dt of N2 e power lambda 2 t is equal. You get the same equation here. This is equal to lambda 1 e power, that is that side, N0 e power lambda 2 minus lambda 1 into t. This is the equation. On integrating this result, finally you will get N2 e power lambda 2 t, because I have integrated this one, integration difference get cancelled. This is equal to, and from this side lambda 1 N0 is common, and for this if you integrate for this one with the limits, so you are going to get e power lambda 2 minus lambda 1 into t by
and the denominator will become lambda 2 lambda 1, which is a constant here. So this plus some integration constant that you get as a k here. And now by substituting these values, finally you will get this equation as this n2 is equal to, that is the final equation, this n2, number of nuclei of B that are formed in this process is given by lambda 1 n0 by lambda 2 minus lambda 1, that is which is brought outside. The remaining terms are e power minus lambda 1 t minus lambda 2 t. So this is the equation that can be solved by substituting this integration constant k there.